You guys have signed a ton of PPAs, and I'm curious as to who you're signing with. Are these all big tech companies calling you up?
Yes. Well, great to be here. We are the biggest seller of renewable energy to corporations in the world, and we're the biggest seller to data centers. So certainly what we're seeing is a great expansion of demand for energy, renewable energy, to data centers. So yes, we're seeing very much an increase in demand and really new locations that are looking for renewable energy.
And is this sort of, you're building, say, a wind farm that's going to connect to the grid and then data centers get some of that? Or is this going to be sort of direct power to data centers?
In most cases, it does go through the grid.
Okay.
So what we do is not just sign what's called a power purchase agreement for a certain amount of energy. In many cases, we're shaping that energy for what the data center needs. So in many cases, it is really more sort of around-the-clock renewables. And for that, we have to add batteries, or we have to combine wind, solar, and even hydro to get that additional renewable energy that the data centers want.
Is there enough? Like, at some point, the data center is going to be like, I can't do it. I can't get to the grid. I can't do energy. I got to shut it down.
Well, I think that the key is that if you look at the forecasts, we certainly have more shortages, let's say, of renewable energy to really be able to power all that growth. So the real important thing is to get that power when they need it. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the things that AES has done. Since 2020 to the present, we're the only really large renewable player in the U.S., which hasn't had to significantly postpone or abandon any project. Mm-hmm. So we've been able to have to deliver that energy, and that's what our clients want, because the most important thing is to have the energy when they inaugurate that data center.
And I'm going to ask about that in just a second, but who are the data centers? Like, what kind of companies are we talking about?
Well, we're talking about what's called a hyperscalers, okay. Principally. So you can imagine a lot of the Magnificent Seven are our clients.
So then how do you build stuff? Because we see a lot of write-downs from offshore wind, like from Ørsted. Sure. Why are you able to do all of this when other people seem not to be able to do that?
Well, I think it's that we've been preparing for this for a long time. So I think that one of the biggest disruptors was COVID. So we prepared very early, as soon as COVID started, let's say, in Asia, we were concerned about its effect on our supply chains. So being one of the largest developers and having strategic relationships with these suppliers, we were able to lock in and bring on shore a lot of the equipment that we needed. Since we're also international, we're able to move things around, which other companies can't do. So for example, just take this year, 2024, we already have 100% contracted of what we're going to build this year. We already have 80% of it on site.
So how does inflation then affect you if you're building stuff like that quickly?
Well, what we do is we lock in equipment prices and the financing at the point that we sign a long-term agreement. So when we sign, say, a 20-year power purchase agreement, at that moment in time, we've locked in interest rates and we've locked in equipment, and we've actually even locked in EPC contracts for the building of it. So we're really not, let's say, taking any naked risks at those points. Now, inflation has affected us all in the sense that, input prices went up. That has been reflected in the power purchase agreement prices. Mm-hmm. But what we have seen is that we were able to, control these costs, pass on these costs, pass on the highest interest rates. So if we look at it, 2023 was our best year ever, and 2024 is looking even better.
So basically, you do it all at the same time.
Yeah.
So which means that you're hedging your risk very aggressively. So if prices, though, fall, you miss that margin. But if they go up, you're protected.
That is correct. I mean, but since what we lock in are returns, we know what the power price is. Mm-hmm. So if we know what all the inputs is, we've locked in our return. So it's true that, I think a lot of people who got in trouble were waiting for prices to continue to come down. Mm-hmm. But I was an economist at the IMF. So the one thing I was certain when COVID hit and saw these huge stimulus, you were having a supply shock and at the same time a huge fiscal stimulus, that sooner or later there would be inflation. So we were very, as soon as COVID hit, we started changing our philosophy of contracting from waiting to really getting ahead of it.
That's interesting. So if the Fed cuts 2, 3, 4, however many times this year, does that affect you?
I would say that it would be good for our stock. because we certainly have been punished when interest rates went up, even though we're not affected by it. Because if we were, you know, 2023 wouldn't have been our best year ever. Nonetheless, I would say from our contracting, sure, it would mean interest rates are lower, the costs to our clients are lower, and so we would pass that on.
What is sticky inflation right now for you? Like, I appreciate you're not exposed to day-to-day price swings then, but what have you noticed when you are signing these contracts? Where are prices stickier, and where are they coming down?
Well, certainly coming down for things like lithium-ion batteries. Mm-hmm. Those have come down quite dramatically. I would say that also solar panels have come down from their peak. When you're looking at construction costs, those have not come down. You know, those are more sort of wage related, and there's a lot of demand for construction of renewables. So certainly what is input prices of, you know, batteries, solar panels especially, have come down significantly or where they were about, say, 12 months ago.
How much are wages, still going up, or are they just not going down?
I would say that, well, they haven't come down. Okay. So what we tend to do is have strategic EPC contractors. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that we can do that the smaller players can't is say, look, these are the projects I'm going to build over the year. So they can hire a crew and then move it to subsequent ones. Mm-hmm. When you have like sort of one-offs, it's more expensive because you have to hire everybody, then let them go, then rehire them for the next one. So that's one of the ways we've worked to have predictable prices over time.
So what are your returns for different projects?
Yes, at the project level, mm-hmm. levered project level returns, we're at about over 13.5%.
Really? That's not what the industry thinks a renewable project return is. It seems like they think it's somewhere between 5% and 9%.
Yes, I think that, well, there's several things. You know, not only do we have the economies of scales, but we're using a lot of new technologies. Mm-hmm. I would say, in addition, we have we sell down the projects once they're built, and then we also have I'd say quite innovative ways of financing them. So that's, you know, all put together, you know, between financing. Between our sell downs, between the use of tax equity, we get these higher returns.
Do the returns differ based on like a solar project or wind project, et cetera, or is it just management?
Again, many times we're combining these. So I'd say at least half of our solar have a battery component.
Interesting.
So I would differentiate, you know, you could say that to some extent wind projects tend to have slightly higher returns mm-hmm. than just solar projects. The combined projects tend to have higher returns than just pure solar projects. Now, the other thing is interesting is that we also do international. So we see higher returns international, even though they're the same clients.
Interesting. Well, why do you think?
Well, I think that there is less competition in some of these markets. You know, there's less people with a pipeline who can actually deliver these projects.
Interesting. In terms of other in terms of where we're also seeing the demand, so we're going to talk about data centers. Mm-hmm. What is your view on hydrogen? Sure. So I feel like I hear a lot about hydrogen. Sure. It's going to be green, and it's going to be powered by wind, and right. It's going to be powered by solar, and it's going to be amazing, right. And that's going to bring the cost of electrolyzers down, and it's going mm-hmm. to solve all the world's problems. Are you getting calls from hydrogen hubs to be like, come power yes. my electrolyzer?
Well, we say we're selected for two of the government's 7 hydrogen hubs. Mm-hmm. So this is Los Angeles and Houston. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we're very excited about that. But we have the most advanced green hydrogen project in the U.S., mm-hmm. of the large ones at least. So this is a $4 billion project in Texas, near the Panhandle, together with Air Products. And this is a very interesting project because it's 1.5 gigawatts. It's on a retired coal plant site. So it's interesting because, you know, you're taking a community which, you know, had a lot of employment go away. We're building a new site there. It would produce about 200 metric tons per day. But what I would say is that, you know, the regulations came out quite strict, mm-hmm. But I think it's important that, you know, we really produce green hydrogen, which is low carbon in intensity. So what do I see? I see that the new technologies are coming that will make electrolyzers cheaper. So I don't think just sort of massifying green hydrogen is going to bring the cost down. Because think of what we've been talking about today. You have tremendous and growing demand from data centers. And mm-hmm. then if you had a huge demand coming on from green hydrogen simultaneously, we wouldn't be able to actually meet that. So what I think is that the way this will happen is that green hydrogen will come in a little bit over time, sort of more like in the 2030s is when we'll have this coming on. But I'm very hopeful about the cheaper costs of electrolyzers, but not just from massification, from new technologies as well.
How do you think about hydrogen? Will you make hydrogen, and then hydrogen will be used to sort of power itself?
Oh, no, that's a great question.
Or is it going to be used for ammonia, et cetera?
Yes. I think when people discuss a lot of the energy initiatives, mm-hmm. It's good to sort of go back to the physics. So you lose energy when you take renewable power to make hydrogen. Mm-hmm. Then you have to store it cryogenically or under pressure, and then you have to transport it. So it really doesn't make a whole lot of sense to take green hydrogen and transport it somewhere to burn it in a power plant. It doesn't make a lot of sense in most cases to use green hydrogen instead of batteries, because you're not making all those, you don't have to transport the batteries. You just charge up the electricity and discharge it. So it's actually much more efficient. However, green hydrogen has a key role to play, for example, in long-haul transportation. Batteries are heavy, so you don't want big trucks hauling huge batteries around, because that is very wasteful. Hydrogen is much more energy dense. There are things that electricity can't do, like green steel, like green cement. Hydrogen can do that because it's combustible. Hydrogen can also be made into ammonia and used for example, shipping, a low carbon way of shipping. Also in fertilizers. So I think what's very important is to have, not only think of the subsidies, but does this make sense? Is it the best form of energy to complete that task?
Is it?
Yes, I think those tasks that I mentioned, green hydrogen can do things that electricity can't do.